University of Dubai and also the Student Experience Officer. I work with them closely and I'm a part of the UAE Careers community. Enough about me, and now we're going to go straight head on career pathways from secondary education up until university. Now, when I talk about secondary education, a lot of you guys must be thinking it's 11th grade, 12th grade, 10th. That's when you start thinking about university. Well, the surprise factor is actually you start from grade 8, or even better, grade 7. It needn't be more of actually selecting universities, but I'm going to take you through the entire pathway of how you can start from grade 7 and plan a very well sought out to university plan so that you have your go-to plan and you do as it says. Now, the first thing we're going to do is basically see what are the things you need to do in order to have a perfect plan. So narrowing down your interests and passion. How would you do that? One is know yourself. Second is exploration. Third is you have a decision making. Fourth is planning. And the fifth one is implementation. As you can see on the right-hand side, I have sought out to a very well-written quote and well-set quote by Oprah Winfrey. It says, passion is energy. Feel the power that comes from focusing on what excites you. It is very important to be able to wake up every morning and be happy to go to work. It's, of course, there are days which are blue. Every day is not all flowery and rosy, but definitely you should have a passion or a job or a career where you enjoy yourself most of the times. The first thing, knowing yourself. Now, when you know yourself, the reason why I have put in this 20 up until 100% is because we're going to see how you're going to be able to reach the 100% from now. So knowing yourself, one thing, is you're going to work on your interests, your abilities, your skills, strengths, values, and aptitude. Now, all of this can be sought out to in your schools. I'm pretty sure a lot of schools have something called a psychometric test. Well, a psychometric test might seem mundane and boring a lot of times, but very frankly, if you answer them properly and if you take an actual interest in it, it kind of gives you a fair idea of all these six aspects, which gives you much more value and much more oomph in order to select what you are good at, in what you're passionate at. Sometimes, for example, if I take myself, I wasn't really sure of what I wanted to do. And very frankly, a psychometric test helped me that I am a creative person. I'm a people's person. I'm good at managing things. I can talk a lot, as you can see. But I used all of that and came up with career counseling and career coaching and sought out my interests and values in my everyday job. And I don't feel that I'm working one day. It feels like, of course, yes, as I said, I do have my days, but a lot of the times I enjoy most of it, what I do. And it's really empowering when you love your job. Moving forward, the second step is exploration. Basically gathering information. This is the part where most of the people want to set back because this is the research part. So 40% of your work to reach 100% is done by the time you gather your information. So number one, what you need to do is stream you wish to venture into. May it be medicine, may it be business, may it be pure sciences, mathematics, whatever it might be, just select a stream and see which one interests you first and which one you want to venture out into. The second thing you will do is select the subjects that are desired in your field. So for example, if you select, say, medicine, and in some countries, you require to do math and biology and chemistry. Some you just require math and biology. So it depends on which country you're going to, which comes up to the curriculum you have to select, which is best for you. For example, requirements in India might not be the same as requirements in a Canadian university. does, it is very important for you to select a curriculum. For example, if you're an IB student, I'm pretty sure there are a few IB students here. So if you are an IB student and if you want to go to India for your entrance exam of medicine, it won't be very possible or feasible because your IB examinations finals and your entrance exam for an Indian medical school, they clash. So it's very important for you to know what you want and select your curriculum accordingly. The fourth one is, what are the careers in your field? I'm going to go on with the medical example because I'm going on with it, but I will also come to other examples as in when we go forward with the PPT. So for example, after you do your MBBS, you can definitely go on and do any specialization that you wish. There are so many of them and I'm pretty sure I don't know a lot of them myself. So go on to Google, see what excites you, see what you like reading, talk to people that are in that field and see if that's something you want to do for the rest of your life. Moving forward, I'm going to talk about self-efficacy. Now, what is self-efficacy? We spoke about actually doing the things, probably selecting the stream, your curriculum, so on and so forth, but we didn't speak about how. So the question is how. Self-efficacy is basically a personal judgment of how well or poorly a person is being able to cope up with a given situation based on their skills and they have a circumstance in their face, how would they deal with it? So number one is talk. Talk to a person who's already employed in the field you're interested in. All right, this gives you a first-hand experience into what you might be getting into. Second is spend time. Now, when I mean by spend time is spend several days watching a professional working in the field of your interest, whether it be an internship, whether it be a shadowing program, talk to your career counselor and ask her in your school if she can be able to give you something like a shadowing program. Probably ask peers, their parents, your parents and their friends. There is always someone to help you out. Third is the lifestyle. So define to yourself, ask yourself, what is the kind of lifestyle that I want to live? If you are a doctor and if you are also a very family-oriented person, you might have to keep in mind that there are a lot of times where you have to give exceeding hours. As you can see now, the COVID-19 situation, there are so many women, men out of the house, not being able to give the kind of time they would have been. And it's, I wouldn't say it's sad, but it's the need of the hour. And you need to be able to understand that there are certain pros and cons that come with every profession. So just weigh the pros and cons and see which one suits you better. The fourth one is the yearly income. If finance is something that you're really, really inclined towards, that you want a career which really feeds on to your income and you want a good one, then you can definitely see how much is the yearly income. Every profession has a yearly income. You can go on Glassdoor and find that out. Glassdoor.com, it's a very famous website. I think you'll get a lot of information about a lot of companies and their basic incomes on professions through that. The fourth one is work experience. Now, I know you guys are children. You're in school and you'd be like, ma'am, but how can I get any work experience? Well, there is a way. What I mean by work experience is not just going to work and getting a wage. That's not what I mean. Not going, you know, I'm going to do an internship for a week and I'm going to know everything. No, that's just to look good on your CV or your college application, which is not going to do too much justice to you as a human being. So what you're going to do is you're going to talk to people around you, ask them if you can intern for at least a month, of course, with feasible hours. And because it's going to be a not-for-profit to yourself internship, you'll be able to learn a lot of things. Make sure to get an internship where you're just not, you know, picking up glasses and making coffee for people. Of course, that's a kind of internship, but try to get an internship very much closer to what you're interested in or what your field demands. Now, going forward, talking to a career counselor, I think everybody makes it a point to talk to a career counselor at some given point of time. I'm pretty sure you have a career counselor at school. And if you don't, please feel free to reach out to me. talk to any career counselor or even a faculty member, that means your teacher, in a department you're considering your career in. So they'll be able to give you a fair idea of what you can expect and what not. Now on the right hand side, I've put a very funny sort of picture which says that I have been working on my life plan. And the other fish says that mostly theory, right? Now, all of this sounds kind of constrained to actually do it yourself. But trust me, put it down on paper, make a lovely mood board if you have to. Boys, even you. And it's completely fine if you do. And make sure that you implement this. It shouldn't be just words. It shouldn't be just something that you're working on and it's, you know, scrapped by the end of next year. No, just work on the same plan again and again. And it's okay to change your plan, but know that you're doing it for a reason. Moving forward with more of self-efficacy. The next one is resist. I know a lot of you have your parents and your friends who, you know, push you to do a particular career. Please don't do that. Do your own research because you're capable of doing that. Know your interests because you need to. And try not to have your relatives and parents and friends push you into a career that they believe you're good at. That's not what we want to do. Identify. Identify employers, firms, and institutions relevant to your career. The reason why I keep saying this again and again is because it's so important to network with people in your own field of interest. Not because, you know, okay, I'm just going to talk to them. No, that's not the reason why. The reason why we're talking to them is so that we know what the pros and cons are. We know that if we are getting into this, you know, on a daily basis, will I be able to do that or not? So it's very important for you to speak to such individuals and firms and employers and know the real-time advice. Always take advice from people you do not know. Friends and peers will always tell you information about their personal experience. So take real-time advice from people you don't know, make a LinkedIn account, DM people on LinkedIn, and please feel free to connect to anybody in your field on LinkedIn. Third one is research into two. The reason why I've said this twice, I said it once before in the last slide and here, because now the research continues. Now that you know the above topics, you can start researching even more in detail. For example, certifications. So find out information from all the sources online and offline. You guys are excellent at technology. So you're going to have multiple, you know, things to research on. And then find out courses and certificate outside of your career that will help you to grow. Now, the reason why I tell you to do certifications is because sometimes, for example, I'm going to give you an example of me. I am a BBA graduate, and very frankly, there is no undergraduate or a degree per se for a career counselor or a career coach. That made me think that what is it that I can do next in order to reach to where I am today. So I did certifications on certifications, made sure that I am up to mark with what I'm expected of doing and a little notch more than up to mark than all my peers. So I stand out. It's so important to stand out because there are billions of people in the world. You really want to be a class apart from them and know that you're one of the leads in the competition. Job description. Sometimes it might be written something like marketing intern, but the job description must be completely different. So I'm talking about people who are in grade 12 or year 13 as well. You might have done internships and might not be too happy with it. So just make sure that you read the job description before you apply anywhere. And sacrificing. Find out what you can actually sacrifice or not sacrifice to be in that particular job. And now that you have all of these pointers in play, you can start your bucket list. Now, what I mean by bucket list is decision making. 60% of your work is done here. First thing, interests and abilities. What are your interests and abilities showcase about you, and what is making you more inclined towards this particular field or this particular course or a career? Second, is major and course. Select the major and course you need to pick according to point one. So according to your interests and abilities, just make sure that you select the right kind of major and course, and find out there are a lot of, sometimes the names are different in different countries, but the course material is similar. So read the course material properly. Make a decision about the country. It is so important because, you know, you're going to make a decision about the course you want, or probably about the university you want to go into, but not about the country. Every country has different requirements, including subjects, including the marks you require, including entrance examination. So it's very important to select the country of your choice. Best university. Now, I know a lot of people might be thinking, oh, best university is the QS ranking university. And oh no, that's completely false. Select the best university in the particular country you selected for your course, not according to the rankings all the time. Sometimes even a community college might have a better plan for you than an actual university might have. So it's very important for you to select a university or a college according to your requirements and your course or field requirements. So make sure you do that and just don't go according to the QS rankings. Yes, if you get into an Ivy League school and you have your course over there, that's brilliant. I'm not gonna jitter from that as well. But don't shy away from going into a university that might not be an Ivy League, but might be having an excellent program for you. Finally, weigh the financial costings and have a family sit down about any scholarship, financial aid, etc. you might need. Maybe your family requires a certain amount of help from your end. So how are you going to facilitate that in the initial stages, so on and so forth. Now with the decision making, we're 60% on. Now the planning starts. So we're 80%, approximately 80% on there. So we have selected the stream. We've selected the subjects and the combination of subjects. We've selected a curriculum. We have gone in to select the university. Thus, we've seen and we're going to prepare for the entrance exam like SAT, ACT, TOEFL, IELTS, AP, or any subject-related tests that you require according to the university. So how are you going to do that? Make sure that you, and one before you apply for all of this, make sure that you're enrolling into activities in school, make sure that you're enrolling into internships, volunteering work. It's very important for you to showcase that you're giving back to society something that you have. And then we start the career planning like a boss. Okay, now implementing. The reason why I have put this very funny thing is, are you thinking what I'm thinking? Now you've done so much of planning, so much of it. You've gone on and on about everything that you wanted to do. And we've created a mood board and now it's all on plan. Now what? Implementing. Go according to the plan. There is nothing that can go wrong if you don't go according to the plan. And then you're almost basically 100% towards your career. During all of this time, keep talking to your not peers, not your friends. Keep talking to your faculty, your career counselors, anybody in the field, and make sure that you're basically having a firsthand experience in any field you're putting your hand into. Moving forward, I'm going to bust some myths. And that is exactly the face I have when a lot of students ask me, it's just simple to have a career choice. Well, I'm going to bust some myths here. I would have loved to have a discussion about what are some myths and what are some things that students ask me. So I have had a discussion with a few of my students, and because I've been doing this for a little bit of time now, these are some basic questions that come to me and statements that I have heard multiple times. One thing is, ma'am, something is wrong with me. I don't know what I want to do in life. No, it's completely fine. Talk to people, we're here to guide you. If I choose a major or a career, I'll be stuck with it forever. Says who? It's almost never certain that you're going to be sticking on to the same major and profession you started with. I know, yes, 6 to 7 times, yes. Of course, there are people who are in medicine and they are doctors and they don't want to change because that's what they wanted to do. But sometimes it's completely fine if you want to change your career, even if you know you're in your mid of career or 35 years old and you're like, you know what, I don't want to do this, I want to do something else. Well, that requires planning, but it can definitely happen. Then there's another thing I've heard, that there's a test or an expert that can tell me what to do with the rest of my life. I'm sorry, we are facilitators, we are counselors, we are coaches. We can definitely help you out to understand, or for you to understand, what is good for you. But we can definitely not spoon feed you. As they say, we can take the horse to the lake, but we cannot make him drink the water. It's the exact same thing. I can facilitate you with the kind of choices, interests, passions, and skills you're good at, but the decision has to be made by you. We will guide you. Don't worry about that. So there's one last thing that I generally hear, which I find very funny rather. So job market depend should be primary detriment of an academic choice. So for example, what I meant by that is, I'm giving an example. Right now in the market, data science or AI is very, very much in demand. So I'm going to do that. No. Well, if I know, if I get into artificial intelligence, I'm going to be horrible at it. I'm not inclined towards it. Probably I'll finish my tasks, but I won't be interested in it at all. So please select something according to your passion, according to your interests. And as they say, you will never work a day in your life. Moving on, some gyan, as they say. So once you have chartered a career path, act on it. Because no dream can be translated into reality without an action. Because without action, a good decision becomes a meaningless one. For that, the desire itself can die through lack of an attempt to achieve its fulfillment. This is a lovely quote I had read somewhere, and it has resonated with me through the years that I have been in the job market. It hasn't been long. I'm not that old. But nonetheless, it really resonates with you. There are some things that do come along with you all the time that you're in a career path or wanting to go into a career path. And this quote, "the desire itself can die through lack of an attempt to achieve its fulfillment," has stuck on to me. Thus, we're all going to wrap up with this, of course. And that's a wrap. Thank you. I'm going to open the floor to questions. I'd request you guys to please share your screen or your mics. You can unmute yourself, raise your hands. I'll allow you all to speak, and then we can have a Q&A session. I think someone had raised their hand, but I am not too sure who now. But yeah. All right, guys, you can put your questions in the chat box or else put it in the Q&A section and I'll answer them for you. Okay. Someone has asked me, how can you decide when to take a master's degree? Well, this is a controversial question. On a personal note, I took about 2 years to 2.5 years actually to do my job. You know, I got into a job and a career because I wanted to facilitate myself financially. But very frankly, it's highly advisable that you finish your education in one wrap. So once you finish your master's, if you don't need 2 years of work experience, please continue doing your master's, because one thing, it's much easier because you're already in the rut of education. That's number one. Number two is you finish it in time. And once you enter the job market, you're already at a much avid range of even salary, and your job profile is going to be a little bit more higher. So you'll be on a PGTM scale, which means a postgrad scale. So yes, do your master's. Again, it's a self-paced and self-answering question. So if you're doing something like an MBA in a country that requires 2 years of work experience before you get admissions, then you definitely need to get the 2 years of work experience. I hope I answered your question. Okay, what if you can't find work experience revolving around subjects like English literature? Oh, well, you can. It might be a little challenging because it's a lovely stream to go into. We have always made sure we emphasize on the fact of LinkedIn. Please type in the search box English literature or journalist or something like that, and you will get a lot of people. Connect with them and ask them if you can intern with them. So if you can intern with a journalist, you'll probably be much in lines with English literature. Also, you can get in touch with schools and your school teachers who are teaching English. So if that's something that you want to do and see how teaching takes you in English literature, then you can definitely go on with it. And if it's writing, then please connect with journalists. I hope I answered your question, Asuka. Perfect. Do you guys have any other questions for me? Anything even personal, for example, if you have a particular career that, you know, seems very back of beyond, you can definitely ask me. What are the subjects required to be taken in grade 11 and 12 for doing architecture or interior designing? Okay, this is an amazing question. Number one, architecture or interior designing, very frankly, especially in Dubai, doesn't have too much of a requirement as such. But yes, they do advise you to take math and English. If you are and if you need to go abroad, say you need to go to Canada or the US, please take English HL and mathematics SL if possible, if you're in IB, or else you can, if you want to skip the IELTS, that is. And if you are wanting to go to the UK again, it depends on the university, one thing, but you need to make a portfolio. That's one thing that's required of you. And but yeah, math and English, we really advise you to take. It's, even if it is like math studies, if you're in IB, that's fine too. Just take math. And about architecture, for example, in India, you have to do an entrance exam. For Canada and US, it depends on the university you're going into. So it depends if you need to do an entrance exam. But that's about it for subject requirements as such. All right. I am just catching up on all the questions. Just please hold on. Okay. Okay. I am trying to look into a job in finance, precisely into investment banking, wealth management. Unfortunately, due to lack of demand in Dubai, I'm unable to pursue the career. However, it'll be helpful if you do know of any such opportunities, more options, the better. Also, do you recommend a CFA? Wonderful. This is an absolutely amazing question. It's a long one, so I'm going to take some time with it. First thing, because generally in finance accounting, it's a very professional degree. The reason being that a lot of companies have their numbers with these finance executives, and it kind of becomes, I wouldn't say breach of contract, but they might be a little scared to do so. So don't worry. Again, as I've mentioned before, please connect to people on LinkedIn. That's number one. Number two, if I have anybody in, if you're a student of Curtin, you'll definitely get to know more opportunities through the Careers Center. If you're from DESC, you'll get to know opportunities from the school itself. And if not, please feel free to write in to me. I'm going to leave in my email address after the session here. And you guys can just email me and then we can get on an individual counseling session if you're from Curtin and we can work something out, definitely. Do you recommend CFA? Absolutely. The reason why I'm saying absolutely is because the fact that you asked me a question like this is you're looking into it and you definitely want to make sure that, you know, you're a notch above. It's again a professional certification. So if you're looking into going all the way in, please do your CFA and try to do it along with your university. So probably in your second last semester or third last semester, you can start with your CFA preparations. I hope I answered your question. Okay, the next one is HR or PR a good occupation for the future? Of course, always. We'll always require HRs, we'll always require PRs. It's a never-ending profession. Again, as I mentioned in my presentation, do not select your profession according to what future holds for you entirely. Yes, of course, weigh the pros and cons. But if you're somebody who's passionate about being in the HR industry and the PR industry, please go ahead. There's absolutely no shame. And it's a very lucrative career. Don't worry about it. Okay, I hope I answered your question. So be positive. Okay, do some degrees from specific universities matter more than others? For example, based on the country. No. Can I just say that, please? Okay, no, I'm going to explain to you why I said no. Okay, I'm going to give you an example. I'm Karishni Damania. I went to Harvard and did my Bachelor's of Business Administration. And I'm Karishni Damania. I went to Mithibai College in Mumbai and got my business administration. The course remained the same, but because it is one of Ivy League schools, the name might seem a little more, but that doesn't determine what skills you've honed during the entire course. So don't worry about it. As I said, even if you do it from a community college, it doesn't matter as long as it resonates with your requirements. So nothing like that at all. Of course, it depends on what you're trying to do. If you're trying to settle down in a country outside, for example, if you're trying to settle down in Canada, yes, then of course it's advisable you do your education from there itself so that it's, you know, easier. You can work there for a while and then apply for your PR as well. So that's that. But other than that, no, I don't think it has made any difference for me that I studied in India. I'm doing my master's from Dubai. So no. And I don't think there's going to be any problem about that. As long as you want to settle outside, then no. Okay. Are courses for architecture and interior designing related, and which sciences are required for the course? Are courses for architecture and interior designing related? I didn't get that. Are you saying that architecture and interior designing go hand in hand or something? Because if that's the case, no, they're two different things. In architecture, you do learn a little bit about interior designing. But might not be vice versa, if that's what you're trying to say to me, maybe. Sciences for interior designing, not required. You can be an art student and be, even for architecture for that matter, just, yes, English and math, as I've mentioned before. But if you want to take up sciences, for example, I was a science student in grade 12, but it didn't matter for, I think it was just, maybe yes, if you are a little bit more inclined towards physics, some universities might require physics. So just see the requirements of the university. But as much as I know, even an arts students or a commerce stream students can select architecture. Yes, but some things might get a little easier because there are some subjects in the architecture field. When you're studying it, some units might have a little bit of science. So yeah, physics probably will help you out, definitely. I hope I answered your question, Shruti. All righty. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to leave my email address in the chat box. We're getting a bit over time. So I'm going to be very mindful of time and just leave down my email address here. If you have any queries, please feel free to either sign in here. I mean, email me here. Or else you can just reach out to me on LinkedIn. I'm pretty active there as well. Okay.
Thank you very much, Ms. Karishni. That was a very informative session. I'm sure a lot of students have taken the best of knowledge from you. And as I mentioned, Ms. Karishni has been very vital, especially for Curtin University in helping a lot of students. So if you have any questions or any suggestions that you'd require, as she mentioned, please feel free to reach out to her, and I'm sure she'd be able to give you really